According to the ancient Irish Druids, they believed it was like a portal to another dimension. They gave the ability to commune with the dead, uncontrollable ferocity, shape-shifting, and last but not least, foresight, the gift of premonition.
Folk reality.
Thank you.
chest and tap them on the shoulder anymore. You have to hit them with a sledgehammer. And then you'll notice you've got their strict attention.
Disgusting man who could barely stand up. A man who, if you saw him on the street, you'd point him out to your friends so that they could join you in mocking him. A man who, if you saw him while you were eating, you wouldn't be able to finish your meal.
Couldn't bear to go on living if she couldn't be beautiful on the outside.
a drug dealer, a drug-dealing pederast, actually. And let's not forget the disease-spreading whore.
You fucking freak! Shut your fucking mouth! You fucking freak! You fucking freak! You fucking freak! Shut your fucking mouth!
This shitty. Could you even try to say these were innocent people and keep a straight face?
We see a deadly sin on every street corner, in every home. And we tolerate it. We tolerate it because it's common. It's trivial. We tolerate it morning and night.
up, but they keep you alive while they cut you up so they can see what makes you tick, and they'll see what makes you sick, and I'll be there. Oh yeah, I'm gonna be there to see you.
species that worships the one over the many. You glorify your intelligence because it allows you to believe anything. That you have a destiny. That you have a right. That you have a cause. That you are special. That you are great. But in truth, you are born insane. And such misery cannot be allowed.
Yeah. This is Brian of Velvet Acid Christ, and I'm here with Todd Loomis, who is also a member of Velvet Acid Christ, who did a lot of work on the last record, Lust for Blood, and helped out a bit here on the new record that's about to come out this fall. So anyway, the record is, it's almost like you could say it's a departure from the last in a weird way, but in the same sentence, you could say it's actually kind of the next logical step, but at the same time, we were influenced a lot by a lot of new music. And in particular, I was listening to a lot of Tegan and Sarah, which is really strange. I discovered it by accident, and we kind of got into playing a lot of acoustic guitar on this record because I actually was having a lot of interesting situations in the studio trying to get my gear to sound right and, you know, learning all the new stuff I'd bought, and for some reason the acoustic guitar seemed like the most logical choice to basically come up with most of the song forms and writing, and it was more solitary and it was easier just to pick up a guitar and just start playing it and coming up with ideas and stuff. But there's also more electronic stuff on the record, and I bought a bunch of XOX kind of gear, some drum machines and some modular synthesizers and stuff like that, and that kind of forced me back into the old school method of making analog dance music. But the sequencer was kind of interesting to get my head around, and so it kind of ended up sounding a little hypnotic and repetitive because of that. I'm pretty happy with that. It turned out in a way that sounds a lot different than the older VAX, and there's always been arpeggios and stuff in VAC, and that's been kind of one of the foundations of the band, is to have really acidic sounding arpeggios. With a modular and some of this XOX gear, we were able to really push that to the next level in a way we'd never had done it before, and make it more minimal and kind of cut in a way that's interesting. As far as the direction as a whole, it was kind of a more emotionally heavy record to make because of, I don't know, a lot of the events that transpired over the last couple of years, and just more the isolation that has happened in my life. Todd and I didn't work as closely on this record. He was doing his solo project, which is the Twilight Garden. I was kind of in hermit land, just locking myself away from the world, I guess. Not really hanging out or anything, and going places, just working on music, and yeah.
Well, then I guess I had moved up to Boulder, which is kind of further away. I don't know, it just seemed like between the extra distance and just me on my project, and personally, I think it's kind of good that you did something that's a little more solo-based. I don't know. I think it can be good to work alone sometimes.
Yeah, definitely. I think it needed to happen.
Maybe not all the time, but...
Well, just more or less because of the weird perspective I've ended up in over these years, especially in this part of my life. Introspection is a lot different. It's strange. So in a sense, I think it's been more therapeutic for me in that regard.
I think the album sounds really intimate. And really, it feels really honest and stuff, and maybe it's just because of that, I don't know.
Yeah, I think it is, because a lot of the production got stripped down, and I was really influenced by a lot of music that was simpler and more to the point, and, you know, having more of a heavy emotional content to it. And some people might think, oh, the drums are so simple in some parts, and it's like, well, we did that because I did it intentionally to try and make it sound a little bit more hypnotic and dizzying in a way that's heavy. You know, like when you start to kind of dwell on heavy emotions, your thoughts tend to spiral in a repetitive way. And I kind of felt like I wanted to make the songs kind of sound like, you know, like you're losing yourself in a really panicky depression or a really, you know, down moment or something. And I think if I was to just, you know, rock out on a record and make all these drum fills and constantly overplay and music, when you're trying to like really focus on heavy emotions like that, it kind of can really ruin the the flow of the intention of the actual art itself.
Yeah, I think some of the songs are simpler than others, but I think the simple thing actually works really well on this record. I like it. But I, that being said, I don't have a problem with simple stuff sometimes. I think sometimes simple is actually better because it sort of strips away all the... You know, you can almost hide behind effects and behind all these spectacular sounds and things, but when everything is stripped barren, there's like all that's left is the essence of what's there, and I think it's cool. You know, that's, I mean, that's my opinion, but you know, that although you've had some... You've done so many records with so many different synth parts and so many different sounds and everything over the years and stuff. It's like the reason you were able to do all that is because of who you are and what you're interested in and all that. And it's like, so even when you strip all that down to something that's really barren, it still works because you're still the artist, still making the music with that sound, and it's cool.
In production,
I don't have a problem with that at all.
And from a production standpoint, it gets a lot easier when you just focus on a riff or an idea or a sound, and you have everything kind of uniformly follow it, and then you just do like a counter melody off of it, and you keep it simple. It's easier to engineer, it's easier to mix, it's easier to make it sound better. And I think that's something that I was trying to really achieve on this record, was to kind of use a stripped down sound and try to make it, you know, sound better than anything I'd done in the past as far as actual production value.
Totally. And I think it made it sound more like unified or something also. It sounds really solid because of that, I think. I like it when stuff builds off of, like, you know, if one piece is interesting enough to be interesting by itself, and then you build on that, and then the two become something interesting together, it's like everything seems really unified when you work that way. So I like the connect of it.
Yeah. So I was really happy about making things simpler, not because it was easier. In my opinion, making this album simple was one of the hardest things I've ever done, because you always want to overplay, you always want to add more, you always want to just keep caking it on, and a lot of that comes from, like, you know, your musical insecurities, you know, like, let's, you know, make it bigger and fatter and, you know, all this stuff so that we can hide in it. And the thing that's really different about this LP versus a lot of the older Vac is, you know, my voice used to always be really buried in the mix. It was kind of hard to understand, and artistically I kind of made it that way because I wanted it to be a little bit more mysterious. And production-wise, I put a lot more layers of synths, a lot more layers of drums and stuff, and you make that big wall of sound, and there's not a lot of room left to add a detailed voice in there. And this record, it's the opposite. It's more like I focused on the vocals and the lyrics as being the driving force of the entire LP. And that's what so kind of scares the crap out of me, is my voice actually carries the record a lot more than any of the past records have.
Yeah, I mean, it definitely feels different in that sense. But I think actually, even despite that, like, a lot of the synth sounds are... I think the synth sound really awesome. Some of them are really incredible, and the way that you nailed some of the guitar tones and everything is really good. But you're right, it does sort of feel like it's sort of more focused around the vocal. But the parts that are there are really cool. It really helps. I like it.
Well, so. Also, I kind of wanted to make it sound like, you know, you're listening to some lonely guy with his guitar, you know, kind of howling away on half the record. I mean, only half the record is really like that.
Yeah,
and the other half is a lot more, you know, dance and club oriented and accessible in that regard. But the album is kind of like definitely like a bipolar thing, where I have this hyper dance type spastic energy in me that creates these like tranced out dance tracks, and then I have this like really isolated, depressed, lonely person who sounds like he's just given up on everything. And that kind of makes for this really weird combination of music on the LP that makes it like almost like a bipolar roller coaster ride or something like that.
It's weird to even talk about it like after it's all done, you know. It's like all those things, all the things happening in your life and everything, you know, during the time you're making all the music, and then now the album's done, and it's like here you are discussing it like post whatever the hell.
I think that's one thing a lot of people don't really understand about music production is some people are I guess, fake, and they just write music because it's their job, and they just like to write music because they're trying to make a painting or whatever. And I think me in particular, I always kind of make art to show what I'm actually feeling more than I'm like, oh, look, I wanna paint a pretty picture and hang it on your wall. I look at it more like I'm gonna take a picture of what I'm feeling, and then you're gonna look at it and you might not like what you see or what you hear because it might bring you down or something, but it's honest.
Yeah, I like that too. I mean, a lot of my favorite art is like that. Like, it kind of reflects, it reflects life, you know? It's like the artist looks around at life, like makes music based on their experience in life, and like it feels that way. And it feels alive because of that. You know, I think that's what gives it energy. It makes it sound really interesting to me. And stuff that doesn't do that is, I don't feel as drawn into.
Yeah. One of the songs on the record, Black Rainbows. I'd had a basic idea of that song for years. I just never produced it, and this. Recently, one of my friends online, he called me, and his mother had passed away, and it was really tough. You know, I tried really hard to help him with it and get him through it, but just that anguish and that pain, it kind of wore off of me in a way, and really produced that song based on that energy from that moment, and. Really kind of talk about that whole thing in a weird, vague way that anybody can interpret their own way, but it really is inspired by, you know, like, I've passed and you'll miss me and I failed and all the horrible emotions that come along with losing a loved one. And it's kind of a weird track because it's probably one of the most polished poppy guitar tracks on the record as far as the song form. So it's really strange in that regard. Our influences, we listen to a lot of really heavy songs. I mean, I really look towards DI6 and The Cure a lot on this record. I listened to The Drowning Man a lot off of Faith, and when I was coming up with a lot of the ideas for this album, and the way that depression ripples through you, like from the old Cure records like that, especially in that song in particular. I really wanted to kind of do that because I was feeling that way a lot when I was making this record. I felt really heavy like that. But not everybody wants to hear depressing stuff, and I really do. My favorite records are these big, epic, sad things. Like, one of my favorite songs ever made is, you know, A Ship Named Despair by the Tear Garden.
Oh, that's a killer.
And that song just can bring me to tears sometimes if I'm in a certain mood. And those are the songs I think that really, really make me, you know, want to run out and buy an album more than just like shaking my butt at a club. So I tried to definitely make something a lot more real and sincere. Well, sad music helps me cope. I mean, sometimes it won't make me sad. Actually, sometimes sad music will actually lift my spirits.
Yeah,
because
it makes you feel better in a way.
It helps me relate. It makes me feel not so alone, and it helps me get it out of my system. And I don't know, it's not always, I don't always listen to that kind of music to be sad.
It can be really soothing.
Some of the best art is definitely tragic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I should talk about some of the stuff on the new record a little bit.
Okay.
Like, Killing a Stranger, for example. I made that song kind of in this weird, desperate state of mind when I was playing with my dogs. I have these two miniature dachshunds. And I was on the floor, you know, playing around with them. One of them jumped up on my head and bit my ear really bad and tore back a big hole in it. You could see the cartilage. It was horrible. It needed stitches, and I didn't really have the money to go to the hospital, and so I just cleaned it out really good. And went psycho, hardcore, raw vegan for like 3 weeks, and my ear healed really good. You can hardly see a scar, and I'm really amazed at how well my body healed up. But the point was, like, in the middle of it, it sucked. I couldn't wear my normal headphones, and so I ended up wearing these earbud things, and it made me sing a lot differently. It was really strange. But I remember, you know, I had when it first happened, I kind of wrote the song in this weird mental state, and I was like panicking over the whole situation. It was strange, because you know, as a kid, when I was young, I got bit by a dog really bad in the face, and I ended up in the hospital, and was in the hospital for like a month recovering from this nasty face infection that I got from being bit by a dog when I was a kid. So I had this weird like OCD anxiety about dog bites and animal bites, because I've had them get really infected and basically put my life in danger. So that was interesting. So that's kind of what happened there. It was weird. And then when I was working on the final mixing and mastering, I got scratched by my cat and went into the worst allergic reaction I ever had in my life. And I had to go to the hospital because I probably would have died if I didn't get an epinephrine shot.
It's odd that somebody with as much concern for animals such as you would be
have such bad luck. Yeah, well, everything happens for a reason.
Yeah, in a way, maybe the animals have blessed you in return by making bringing your mood down and making so you could make this album.
It's pretty weird.
That's like amazingly fated.
Yeah.